Everybody, thanks for coming this morning. I'm Louis Lund, president of Regis, and I'm introducing a presentation by Jennifer Stanek. Jennifer, if you read the bio, has worked at Cyril in analytical and then going into CMC and regulatory, and been an independent consultant for
8 years.
8 years, okay. And 4 years has done work with Regis, so she's brought in, filed 9 drug master files on 3 different APIs. So very, very talented woman. Jennifer gave this presentation to Regis maybe a year ago, and as it turns out, things move quickly with GDUFA and such, so it was even updated since the presentation gave to Regis last time. So we thought it'd be a good thing to bring out to the Chicago community, and hopefully you'll find it educational. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Louis, for inviting me. Can everyone hear me? I do have a microphone on, but I think it's for the video, and I know my voice doesn't carry very well. Is it okay in the back? Okay. I feel like there's a lot of folks in the room who probably have quite a bit of experience themselves with DMFs, so hopefully I won't insult your intelligence too much with some of this, but hopefully you'll pick up a few nuggets, and there probably are people here who have not done too much with DMFs, and hopefully you'll learn a lot more. So as Louis mentioned, I did start out in industry as an analytical chemist for approximately 7 years. Overall, I have 25 years experience in the pharmaceutical industry. I've worked in CMC regulatory affairs for 18 years. Most of that was at Cyril, doing global submissions, DMFs, NDAs, a certificate of suitability with Ron here. For 8 of those years, I have been an independent consultant. And as Louis mentioned, I have consulted with Regis for 4 years. My numbers may be a little outdated, but certainly I've worked on DMFs, 3 different APIs. It may be 12 to 15 global submissions that we've done now. So here's the agenda that you've seen. We'll go just do a basic overview or purpose of the DMF or the CMC. We'll go over the US DMF process. We'll get into the content of the Type 2 US DMF, things you might want to consider in preparing your DMF. In terms of, you'll have all these internal reports. What do you do with those? Where do those go in the DMF? We'll go over your responsibilities in maintaining the DMF. And then there's a few brief slides on an ex-US overview of how, mainly of how the US process differs from the other agency processes, just enough so that you're dangerous, so you know you need to look into what those processes might be. It's not the same. Basic overview, there are laws that we need to abide by, the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, the newest one, GDUFA, the Generic Drug User Fee Act, which was just finalized October 1st, 2012, and then there's PDUFA that we've been working under for quite a while. There are regulations that we need to abide by, and for DMFs, these are typically in Section 314.50 for the content and format, 314.70 for how you do changes to your DMF or other submissions, and then there is a Section 314.20 on drug master files. I listed a website here. So these are all laws and regulations we have to adhere to. Then there's a lot of guidance documents out there that really get to the nuts and bolts and details of what you really need to consider and what the FDA is really expecting. The guidance documents are not binding, but if you're going to deviate from those guidance, you really probably should have a pretty good reason of why you're going to deviate. This particular website is pretty nice. It's not I don't think it's organized too well. It's not bullet point. It's not very appealing to the eye. It's kind of a stream of consciousness. But there are a lot of good hyperlinks to other guidance documents, both on process of submitting your DMF and on content of submitting the DMF, and the pesky little idea of fees for your DMF. Basically, a DMF is not required. A DMF is a way for a company to protect their intellectual property, but yet allow a company to reference that intellectual property and have the FDA review that information. Like I said, it's not required. It can be used to support an IND, an NDA, an ANDA, or a supplement to any of these. It also could be used in another DMF. If you could have a DMF for an intermediate of your process. And then the DMF for the API would reference that intermediate DMF. A DMF is never approved by the FDA. A lot of people think, well, I've submitted the DMF, it's on FDA's website, it must be approved. As I'm sure all of us are aware, there's a number of DMFs there that are considered inactive. Even if they've been referenced before, it may say active, but the last time it was referenced was 10 years ago, and there may be big gaps in that DMF if it would be reviewed to today's standards. So if a customer can never ask you, is your DMF approved? It's not. The better question is, when was it last accessed? When was it last reviewed by the FDA? And it only gets reviewed. You can have your DMF sitting there. You could be doing annual updates. But it will not be reviewed from a technical point of view until an ANDA or an NDA references that DMF. There are different types of DMFs in the U.S. We'll be focusing on the... We'll be focusing on the type 2 DMF, but just for your information, there were type 1 DMFs for manufacturing sites. The type 2 DMFs are for drug substances, drug substance intermediates, or they can also be used for drug products. Type 3 DMF is for packaging material. These are typically referenced by drug product or ANDA or NDA submissions and how the finished product is packaged, not necessarily for how an API is packaged. Type 4 DMFs could include information on novel excipients, colorants, and type 5 DMFs, kind of for other. If there's a sterile or biotech facilities that you want to register, facility information, you don't want to divulge that to your customers. That's the way to get that information to the FDA. A little comment here. There are no open and closed parts of a DMF in the U.S. In the U.S., you file... your DMF all is one. All your intellectual property type of information, confidential information, as well as information that you probably do share with your customer, like your specifications, analytical procedures, information on impurities. This is different in many other markets. There is an open and closed portion. You put your proprietary information in the closed portion and everything else in the open portion. And in other countries, you need the ANDA holder, they're not usually called that in other countries, they need to actually submit that open part in their filing. So that's why it's separated out. To have a DMF, there's a lot of relationship going on, so I thought it'd be good to just talk about who is who in this DMF world. There's the DMF holder, and that's the company who submits the DMF. Usually it's the company who is manufacturing the API. There's the DMF agent. Some companies will use a DMF agent if they are ex-US and they want a local presence. A DMF doesn't have to have an agent, but that is a possibility. And then there is the applicant. The applicant is not the DMF holder submitting the DMF. The applicant is actually the company that's relying on the information in that DMF. So it's the ANDA holder or the NDA holder, or the IND holder. So DMF holder and applicant, we really need to keep straight in our minds, particularly when we're doing post-approval changes.